بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. أشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صفيه من خلقه وخليله وأمينه على وحيه. ربنا إننا سمعنا مناديا ينادي للإيمان أن آمنوا بربكم فآمنا. ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا توفنا مع الأبرار. ربنا وآتنا ما وعدتنا على رسلك ولا تخزنا يوم القيامة إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. إن شاء الله we'll continue our weekly class حلقة trying to basically rediscover our deen, our faith, trying to understand what's going on, basically trying to answer some fundamental questions that are in the minds of many of us. Where are we now? How and why we get to this point? How can we chart a course to a better future, at least Muslims stop declining and start climbing. It may take a while, it may take generations, but at least we take charge. Right now, basically, our destiny is not in our hand. I mean, things are planned for us, and we are just watching. We're basically spectators on the global scene. And sometimes when Muslims get involved, they get involved in a negative way. So either we are absent, or when we are there, unfortunately, when Islam and Muslims are talked about, they're talked about in a negative way. And we have to accept this fact. There is nothing, I mean, it's okay for nations to be in crisis. Most nations have gone through crisis, but it's not okay to deny it. That's our problem. It's not okay to say, no, there are some minor problems if we fix. No, there are very severe, deep problems that have to be resolved. So we have to adopt this approach of seeing the reality as is, and have the courage to see it, even if it is ugly. That's the reality. There is nothing you can do about it. It's like diagnosis. That's what it is. And you don't like it, fine, but that's what it is. I mean, you just have to accept it and try to work on it, even if it is bad. So this is same thing when you do assessment of a situation of a community or even your own personal. You have to have that courage to see things the way they are. And then, from those symptoms, try to go to the roots. Problems are solved at the roots. No superficial treatment. We have been doing the superficial treatment for so long. It made only things worse. So from those symptoms, you go to the roots and tackle problems at the roots. And while you're doing that, there is something also that we don't do, and we should, which is to accept responsibility for what happened. All excuses, conspiracy, trying to find somebody to blame, that doesn't work. I mean, we have been trying it. It just doesn't work. You have to accept responsibility for what happened. Things happens for a reason. So whatever happened because of what we did and because of what we failed to do. And that's how the Quran teaches us. That's how the Quran addressed the Prophet and his companions when they were wondering after the Battle of Uhud, how this can happen to us. I mean, we are Muslims, and how can we be defeated? Well, after they winning in Badr, they thought it's going to be, they took it for granted. And Quran says, قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِي أَنْفُسِكُمْ. It's, no, don't look for somebody to blame. It's here. It's because of you. قُلْ هُوَ مِنْ عِنْدِي أَنْفُسِكُمْ. And the verses that were revealed after the Battle of Uhud were very, very strong language. The Quran called it musida, called it failure, وَتَدَ فَشِلْتُمْ. And addressing the community of the Prophet. So Musiba, it's a disaster, it's a failure, it's because of you. Some of you wants this dunya, this life, so your intention was not totally pure. That's the language that the Quran used with the community of the Prophet ﷺ. So we have to be harsh on ourselves when we do assessment. That's the only way we can fix things. And we have to learn. We live in a country, that's how it functions. Alaykum as-salam. You can see president, you can see very high level public official here. When things don't work, they come under scrutiny, and then there is accountability, and that's how it works. Now we have people in most Muslim countries, people who are in charge of the state, people who are in charge of parties, and they did not only mistakes. I mean, they caused disasters, and still remained in place. Nobody has ever evaluated their performance, and no accountability. That's why we keep repeating the same mistakes. So back to the fundamental question: where we are, how did we get to this point, how and why we get to this point? Accept responsibility for what happened, and then have the resolve that to charter a new course for a better future. This is not our destiny. As a community, we are not. This is not our destiny to be from failure to failure. No, this has happened because of what we did and what we didn't do. If we want a better future, then we have to do things differently. Now, start fix things so that inshallah, the future will be much better than now. But to remain in denial, to wish and to use these words and inshallah things will work and maybe and just be optimistic, and all of this lead nowhere. I mean, if these things will work, it would have worked with the community of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Even there are rules. There are rules that Allah has put in this universe. These rules are not biased toward Muslim. These rules, they apply to everybody. If you have justice in a country, that country will thrive, will prosper, even if it is not Muslim. If you have injustice in a country, that country will decline, even if they are praying day and night. That's not how it works. I mean, it's not what you want. لَيْسَ بِأَمَانِيكُمْ, Allah says. It's not with your wishes. لَيْسَ بِأَمَانِيكُمْ. Things don't work because of what you wish. Things work because of rules. Like there are rules that govern the physical universe, there are rules that govern the human, the social part. Why nation and communities excel and succeed? Why nations collapse or decline? These are now, it's becoming a science. There are books that are published. They started with a very famous book Kennedy, not the president. They say, Rise and Fall of Nations. Rise and Fall of Nations. And now, the most recent book, I think, was Why Nations Fail. And this book was focusing on what? It was focusing on a city at the border between the United States and Mexico. It's a city, same people. Part of them are in the United States, and the other is in Mexico. And the author was making the comparison. So it's the same people, but these are very successful, and things are working very effective, and these are very backward. And he explained the things that, because here there is a system, there is transparency, there is accountability, there is room for fair competition. So when you work harder, you get more. Here, it's all corruption, it's messed up, so things are not working. I mean, it's an amazing description, because it's a town that is divided between the United States and Mexico, and it's the same people, as I said, but there is a huge difference between the two. Now, Muslims rise and fall on their understanding of Islam. If Muslims have the proper understanding of Islam, they will thrive. if Muslims are not in good shape, means they have to check their understanding of Islam. Why? Because this Muslim community or nation is the product of Islam. It's like the Islam is the engine. Islam is what produced this. So if the product is wrong, then you have to check the process. If the product is not in good, it's bad, it's not in good shape, then you have to check the process. The process that produces our community is our understanding of this deen. Not the deen, our understanding of the deen. This deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to tell us, when I think about it, I said, why Islam was revealed in the Arabian Peninsula in among those tribes that were fighting each other all the time. People were illiterate, poor. They were fighting each other all the time, and they were in the middle of nowhere in the desert. Why? And I always have come to conclusion that Allah is telling us that if this deen works in those conditions, then nobody will have any excuse. Because he can't think of conditions that are worse than these. I mean, if Islam was revealed to the Roman or the Persian, you can say there is already civilization there, so maybe it will not work for everybody. But it worked in the most unfavorable conditions you can think of. No, they were few in numbers, by the way. Arabs were few in numbers, short in resources. Most of them are illiterate, and they spend all their time fighting each other. Most of the time, fighting each other for silly issues and for survival. And this deen made out of these people champions of great civilization. So basically the message is, if it doesn't work, then you have only yourself to blame. Message very clear, that this deen, if it worked then it should work in any conditions. Nobody has any clue. Nobody can say we don't have enough people. By the way, the number of people who have changed this world are less than the number of people who pray one Jumu'ah in one masjid in North America. One Jumu'ah. We have three Jumu'ahs here. The people who pray here one Jumu'ah or in Dar Hijra, especially big mosques, they are many more than the people who have changed this world with this deen. So number is not an issue. Money, as I said, there was none. There was no resources. So it's all because of the greatness of this deen. So if we are not in good shape, it's our failure. There is nobody to blame. Now what we reach a point now, unfortunately, or let me take a step back, there are some fundamental issues that unless we understand them very well, we're going nowhere. One is the revelation, the guidance is fixed. Life is changing. Who's going to make sure that the deen keep up with life? That's our responsibility. Did we do it? We didn't. That's why we ended up in this mess. The prime responsibility of believers at all times and all places is to keep this deen relevant and keep it inspiring and keep it source of solutions to people and guidance and empowerment. That's what we didn't do. So there is this gap now between the version of Islam that is totally obsolete and between life that has gone way ahead of us. So to the point now, if we want to come to talk to nations that are advanced, we have nothing to contribute. We allowed ourselves to lag behind, way behind. Now if you're going to talk to an American or to a Korean, or what are you going to offer? What do we have to offer? Is this the problem of the deen? No, it's a problem of, we didn't do our job. I mean, the deen, it's like you can think of it as like, you know, the oil? The oil comes raw material, but it has to be processed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us all the ingredients for the solutions, for all contexts, all situations, all problems. But He left it to us to to craft those solutions. Just to give you an idea, how this happened before Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Allah will send new messenger with new message that is customized to those people. That's how this deen remained relevant until Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, until Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Fresh message that addresses the problem of those people. And that remained from Adam to Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Then Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, His wisdom, assigned us that role to do. So gave us all the ingredients, and gave us the manual, and then became our job to craft not a new deen, new understanding. In every context, Muslims find themselves, they have to do the same job that was done before with the new revelation. Now they go to the Quran and extract from it a fresh understanding that is suitable for their time and their conditions. That's the task that probably did not happen over centuries now. That's why until now, you know, we're totally dependent on what? We're dependent on a literature that was written centuries ago. With all my due respect, these people, they did their job for their time. And that product, the product, the understanding that you produce, one, it has to keep to be kept fresh. So it's not one-time exercise. I mean, even if we do it right, which we didn't, even if we do it right, it's not one-time exercise. You have to keep this deen always relevant. And we'll talk about how this can happen. But they didn't. But even if we do it successfully, we do it here for America, you cannot take it to Canada. People in Canada have to do the same thing. I mean, it's not transferable. You cannot transfer it from one country to another. Every people facing in a given context, they have to produce their own understanding of Islam. So those who say that sometimes they use it in a sarcastic way, say it's an American Islam, yes, we need an American Islam, of course. I mean, Islam will have no future until it becomes American here. In other places, it has to become indigenous, everywhere. As long as it remains a foreign entity, it has no future. Now, when you say an American Islam, does it mean that we're going to pray four times a day? No, we're going to pray five times a day. Does it mean that we're going to fast in December? No, we're going to fast in Ramadan. Because these are not the things that are flexible. These are the things that are fixed in Islam. These are the things that don't change. But these are a small part of this deen. So that exercise of meshing or fusing the teaching of Islam with the local culture to produce something that is original, that is indigenous. That was not done. Actually, it was not done even in Muslim countries, not even here. Even in Muslim countries, they are still dependent on the work that was done either centuries ago or thousands of miles away. So people are, I mean, it's basically that we were failing the main task that we have to do. And they kept summarizing it by saying Muslims have, in every context, in every situation, they have to, their prime responsibility is to understand the teaching of Islam, understand their reality, and leverage this deen to fix their life, or to fix their society and their world. So three parts. Understand the deen, understand the reality, because this deen is meant for everybody. It's meant for all situations, it is meant for all contexts. But it doesn't mean that every verse of it is valid for every context, no. Or every hadith. And that's the beauty of this deen. Now we turn something that is, basically, it's an advantage that this deen is comprehensive and flexible. But our failure to do our job, we made it rigid. Now it's frozen, and it's not evolving. So that's something that is, that we have to keep in mind, that our responsibility to keep this deen fresh and relevant. And how do we do it? We do it through this two-way interaction. And we are the bridge between the Quran and the society, what's happening in the world. If we are engaged in societies, which we should, what's going to happen? You take, you infuse the teaching of the Quran in the society. And as you are engaged, you will be faced with new challenges that will force you to go back and dig out new guidance, more guidance from the Quran. Because this does not end. The guidance of the Quran is not limited. It's unlimited. If we do this exercise, again, Muslims should be engaged so that whatever we learn from our deen, we turn it into action that serves the society. Charity, civic, whatever. And then as we get engaged, we'll be faced with challenges and questions that will force us to go back and dig out more guidance and more enlightenment from the Quran and the Sunnah of Rasulullah. If we are not engaged, this whole process stops, collapses. If you are not engaged, then there are no more new challenges. That's why people are relaxed and happy. Why? Mainly because people are not engaged, and so that they are not faced with any challenges, so they are happy with whatever they learned early on. That's one thing. Of course, on top of this, or even before this, comes the fact that this deen came, most Muslims came to this deen through the wrong door. Vast majority of Muslims came to Islam through the wrong door, the wrong way. How? That's what we have been focusing in the last couple of weeks. I said that when becoming a Muslim, it means commitment to mission and goals. Mission that will reproduce results also. It's not only mission regarding, no, mission and goals. You come to Islam, you commit to goals and to the mission that will achieve those goals. Is this the way most Muslims came to Islam? No. Vast majority of Muslims came to Islam committing to tasks. They committed to few tasks to be done and few things to be avoided. And you're done. You're okay. That's why people are very happy, relaxed, that nobody has any guilt feeling or nobody is motivated to do more. Why? Because that's what he committed to, or she committed to. They were told that Islam is what? A list of do's. You pray, you fast, if you have qualify, you pay your zakat, you perform hajj once in lifetime, and you're okay. Plus, you stay away from alcohol, stay away from fornication, and if you're living in a Muslim, non-Muslim society, you don't eat pork, and you are fine. No more. Is this the Islam that was brought by Rasulullah? Definitely not. Is this the Islam that changed this world? It has very little to do, very little in common with the Islam that was brought by Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And as I mentioned before, if Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came up, brought this deen, Quraysh will not fight him at all. Actually, they will support him. They will help him because it's going to take people and then sue them and basically isolate them, make them accept reality, etc. So what was the problem that the prophets have faced from their people was because they were calling for change. They were calling for change. And that's something that people have resisted. They were calling for change because Islam is a message of change. That's the heart of this deen. The heart of this deen is that Islam is a mission. It's a mission of Islah. and i'mar. These two words that are used in Quran, islah, making things better. I'mar is development. Islah, betterment. I'mar, development. That's what this deen came to achieve. It's a mission of to make this world a better place for everybody and to develop this world that Allah has settled us in. That's the heart of this deen. And that's the foundation we should build on it. If it is not there, then don't waste your time. And that's the main reason why I don't focus on details. I want to make sure that there is solid foundation to build on it. Now when this foundation has, well, deen is built on foundation and is built also on some key principles. So before you get lost in details, and there are a lot of details in this deen, you have to have the solid foundation and you have to have these fundamental principles. And then the details will fall in place. And that's why I don't recommend people to go and try to learn this deen without that framework, without understanding the essence of this deen. And that's what Rasulullah ﷺ did. And Rasulullah ﷺ in Mecca, that's what he was doing. He was building that foundation and that frame of mind, frame of reference. So that after that, when the rules of fiqh came and the detailed instruction came, they fell in place because you already have the structure. It's like the way they build the construct. I mean, how they make buildings? Solid foundation and that frame. That's what we're trying to build here. Because I believe that the whole thing has collapsed and has collapsed a long time ago. And we ended up with what? We ended up with a situation that everybody got some pieces of the building and then put them together to come up with his or her own understanding of Islam. That's where we are now. It's a building, beautiful building that has collapsed, and then every Muslim ended up with few pieces, put them together somehow, most of the time haphazardly, and ended up with saying that's the Islam. That has nothing to do. So what we're trying to do here? We're trying to rebuild, reconstruct that understanding of Islam, and then use it to build individuals and build communities. That's the only way. Why? Because when you allow this deen to lag behind life, and when the gap becomes big, no amount of remodeling will work. The remodeling will work if the gap is small. Then you can catch up. But because it's become a huge gap, and because the whole thing is collapsed, there is no point in trying to do any remodeling. Just leave it as is, and that's what I have been trying to do. Leave whatever is there, don't argue with these people, and start chart new course and try to rebuild. And as you know, a lot of times rebuilding is much easier than remodeling. Just build on clean slate. And that's why in doing this, we need to do a couple of things. One, establish the new foundation, solid foundation, and those fundamental principles. Two, eliminate anything that is left, the leftover or the remnant of the wrong understanding or twisted understanding. And that's what Rasulullah ﷺ was doing. As one companion said, كان الرسول يفرغنا ثم يملأنا. The Prophet used to empty us and refill. Empty to take away a lot of misconceptions, a lot of things that are wrong. And nowadays, the Muslim mind is full of them. It's full of misconceptions about deen and about life, etc. It's a total mess. It's totally messed up. So we have to try to erase those misconceptions and at the same time try to rebuild, which is not an easy task. I mean, what we're trying to do is not an easy task. The easier task will be just to get together and do some activities and we're fine, or expand the mosque, etc. But that will lead nowhere. Unless we do this work and we do it right and we do it successfully, how the future is look like in this country? Empty mosques that will be sold back. People were happy purchasing churches. If we're going to continue doing business as we're doing now, we're going to leave nothing for future generations. Already, we are failing to pass on this deen, this version of Islam, to future generations. It's not appealing. And I don't blame them. It is not appealing. It doesn't help them. It's not inspiring. It's not empowering. And they can do without it. I mean, you're not offering anything to them. Actually, when they come to the mosque, what they find? What do they say? Just bring a young man or woman to the mosque and to the Jum'ah. What are they going to hear? They're going to have a take-home message? They're going to have something that will inspire them? They're going to have something that will answer the question they want? No. Get more confusion and more problems. So it's very serious. I've reached a point now, and there is a saying that says, رُبَّ ضَارَّةٍ نَافِعًا. I mean, this madness of terrorism that is now spreading everywhere, it's a disaster, but it was a wake-up call. Now, we have to realize that it's no longer luxury. This war is no longer luxury. Why? Because now we're not talking about even a better future. We're talking about just to exist, to remain relevant, and to remain in this life, and not to reach a point, as one brother mentioned yesterday, not to reach, we were in a gathering, says we don't want to reach a point where being a Muslim becomes a crime. We don't want to reach that. That's where we're heading now. I mean, we're heading that people are so scared of this deen, so scared of Muslim, that's where we're heading. So it is very, very demanding work. Let make no mistake about it. Unfortunately, we don't choose our reality. We all wish that we came at a time where Muslims were in very good shape, where scholars were doing their job so that we didn't have to do this, and we just join and be part of it. Unfortunately, that's not our case. You don't choose your reality, you choose how to deal with it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought us in this time, very hard, very tough times, very challenging. And it requires the big job to be done. It's a huge, I mean, we're in a vicious cycle that has to be broken, and we're talking about something that has collapsed, that needs to be rebuilt, so we're talking about very huge work. But you know what? On the other side, on the positive side, it's a big opportunity to do this work, to be pioneers. If we do it successfully, first of all, it will pay off for generations to come. And second, inshallah, if our intention is sincere, your rewards will be multiplying until the day of judgment. Anything good that happens now goes into the account of the people before, especially the pioneers, those group of people around Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Anything good that happens by Muslims goes into their account. That's what it means to be a pioneer. That is what is needed now. Unfortunately or an opportunity, but that's what is needed. At this point, it needed Muslim pioneers who will, as I said, chart a new course. And that has never been easy, and it will not, because you're going to meet resistance from whom? From Muslims first. Why? Because you're trying to take them out of their comfort zone. You're trying to take somebody out of the comfort zone. Meaning, basically, it's like you're taking away the painkiller. somebody was taking painkiller or somebody was on drugs, and you're trying to take that away so that the person wakes up. And people usually don't want to do that. So they have those soothing ideas. Our deen is great. Our history is great. We are in this situation just because people conspire against us. It's going to go away. Hopefully tomorrow is better. People are fooling themselves. I told you a couple of weeks ago that I was listening, unfortunately, to a scholar who was saying, scholar or leader, saying that I'm optimistic because we are getting closer and closer to victory. And I said, where does he see it? I mean, just show us. We want to see it. I mean, just show us what makes you optimistic so that you'll be optimistic like you. Didn't see anything that makes you said, no, things are going fine, and you are. I see that you are so close where? I mean, and so that's, and you hear it, go to some Jumu'ah and Masajid, alhamdulillah, the community is growing, we're in good shape, compare where we are before, now we have two Jumu'ah, and we have three, and the mosque is full, and then always when I hear this, I say, so what? I mean, Rasulullah ﷺ, when he was describing this situation, how did he describe it? He said, "Tushiku al-umam an tada'a alaykum kama tada'a al-akalatu ila qasatiha." That nations will gather around you like people gather around their food. And the Prophet is saying that you're going to be on the table. Not at the table. You're going to be on the table. "Tushiku al-umam an tada'a alaykum." So nations will gather around the table and you are on the table. Beautiful description. And he kept the companions at that time with the true Islam. He could not imagine this. So what is the only reason they thought about it? Numbers. They say, أَوْ مِنْ قِلَّةٍ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. Are we going to be small in numbers, that's why? Said, no, بَلْ أَنْتُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ كَثِيرٌ. You're going to be too many. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ غُثَاءٌ كَغُثَاءَ السَّيْلِ. You know the form? The form? وَلَكِنَّكُمْ غُثَاءٌ كَغُثَاءَ السَّيْلِ. That's exactly was as if he was living amongst us. The point I was trying to make, as saying being large in numbers, it means nothing. Look at Pakistan, how many large population. Where are we going? Nowhere. And it's not, look at Egypt, look at everywhere. It's not by numbers. So having mosques filled with people, that's not something that should make you very confident about the future. That means nothing. As I said, there are Muslims, I think I heard that Brazil, and I heard from someone who went to Australia. I know that. Go beautiful mosques that are empty. Why? First generation, they built mosques, they didn't build people. They built mosques. So they didn't build people to populate those mosques. They built mosques and then they left. And that's exactly what is happening now. And there are numbers that are very alarming. I heard that there are some colleges, they have hundreds and hundreds of Muslims. You have only a handful in Jumu'ah, in the college. You have Jumu'ah in the college, large Muslim population in that college, and only few people come in Jumu'ah. I'm not talking about anything else, we're talking about Jumu'ah. So that's, imagine that's probably second generation. Imagine third. So you can tell where things are heading. So that's basically what, again, we're trying to do. And with all of this going on, I'm optimistic, not the false optimism. The optimism that, because I believe that this deen is great, that this deen is capable to turn things around, if it just there are people who take it seriously, and they commit to it fully, and understand it properly. So proper understanding, full commitment. And take this deen serious. Things will will can turn with this deal can turn things around in no time, as it did early on. But with these conditions, not with wishful things, thinking, with these conditions. If we rediscover our faith, and that's what we're trying to do, and take it as a mission, commit to it as a mission, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects us not only to pray and fast, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala expects us to do two things. One, to try to understand His plan, and two, to execute it. His plan beyond you, His plan for this whole world. One, to try to understand it, and two, is to turn it into reality. So you understand the purpose of Allah, what Allah wants to happen on earth. That becomes your vision, becomes your mission to make it happen. That's what should motivate the Muslims. Should motivate Muslims is that dream or vision that starts from the moment you stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you find Him pleased with you. That should be your ultimate dream. And then take it backwards. What does it take? So what does it take for this to happen? What should be in our mind all the time is when I stand before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I will find Allah is pleased with me and I can say, I did everything I can. I didn't spare any effort. That's the position that should be in your mind. The moment you meet Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, we honored your legacy. We continued your work. We continued the work that you started. And we did everything we can to continue that along the same line. That's what should be in your mind. Now, if you and backtrack it until you come to this moment. What does it take to achieve that? It takes that, one, to understand, again, the purpose of Allah. Murad Allah. In fact, iradat Allah. That's the role of the believer. To execute the will of Allah. When you become a Muslim, you surrender your own will to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why you become abd. That's what means you become abd. You become abd, servant, and soldier. Meaning what? Meaning you don't have a will of your own. Now you committed to fulfill, to execute the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to enforce the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is this will? That's what you spend your life trying to understand it and trying to make it happen. There are some items, generic items, that apply in all places and all times. Allah wants justice to prevail. Allah wants people to be free. Allah wants people to live in dignity. Allah doesn't like poverty. Doesn't like poverty or oppression or injustice. All these Allah doesn't like them. So become your job to eliminate them. Anything that Allah likes to happen becomes your job to make it happen. Allah wants peace to prevail. Rasul ﷺ made it clear. He said that when my mission succeeds, وَاللَّهِ لَيُتِمَنَّ اللَّهُ هَذَا الْأَمْرِ. Meaning, when my mission succeeds, what's going to happen? حَتَّى يَسِيرَ الرَّاكِبُ مِنْ صَنْعَى إِلَى حَضْرَ مَوْتٍ لَا يَخْشَى إِلَّا اللَّهَ وَالذِّئْبَ عَلَى غَنَمِهِ. Beautiful description. Rasul ﷺ says that when my mission succeeds, he makes it as a criterion. When that happens, what's going to happen? People will cross the Arabian Peninsula, the desert, at that time, fearing nobody, which at that time was unthinkable. It's unthinkable to go even from one town to one town, safely. Rasul ﷺ says, in one hadith, he said, a woman will be able to cross the Arabian Peninsula fearing nobody. That means what? Means it's total peace and harmony. So Rasul ﷺ linked the success of his mission to peace prevailing. And Allah says in the Quran, that he sent messengers and revelation for what? ليقوم الناس بالقسط. Allah in Surah Al-Hadid says, لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. Let's find the exact translation. لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان ليقوم الناس بالقسط. Surely we have sent our messengers with clear signs and sent down with them the book and the scales of justice so that people may conduct themselves with fairness. Anytime when you read the Quran, you find the word so that, you have to pay full attention because that's a goal. When Allah says so that, or لعلكم لي that like here, ليقوم الناس. So that's a goal. And this deen, when you try to understand this deen, you have to start the goals first. Because if you understand the tools without understanding the goals, you may end up astray. That's what's happening nowadays. The people who read verses from the Quran and build on them without keeping in mind the goals of this deen, they end up committing the madness that you say. But the goal is for justice to prevail. So Allah wants people to be free, wants people to live in dignity, wants justice to prevail, wants peace to prevail. That's what the job of the believer to do. Now we left this job and we took the job of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is al-hisab, which he left for himself, which is to judge people. Now we left the job that Allah has assigned us and we did the job that he reserved for himself, which is to tell, this is Muslim, that's kafir. This is a good Muslim, that's a bad Muslim. So who assigned you this role? You have no way to know. And it's not your job even. It's not your job to judge people. It's not your job to convert people. And we'll close with this, inshallah, so that we'll leave more time for interaction. It's not your job to judge people. This judgmental attitude, we have to eliminate it completely from the minds of them. Because, you know, what ends in terrorism starts with judgmental attitude. That's the starting point. When you give yourself the right to judge people, so you say this is kafir, the other will take a step further, say because he's kafir, then we'll kill him. So to solve it, we have to cut it from the root. It's not your job to judge people. And it's not your job to convert them. Never mind to kill them. It's not your job to convert them. So where is da'wah? Where da'wah comes in? Da'wah means what? Da'wah means you make a da'wah to a person means what? Means you bring this person to a position to make a conscious decision about to take Islam or not. That's the meaning. That's the shahada. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says again, when you say goals, he said, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا لِتَكُونُوا شُهَدَاءَ عَلَى النَّاسِ. So made you into balanced nations so that you become witnesses. That's your role. What does the witness do in the court? Make decision? No. Make judgment? No. Bring the judge to a position to make informed decision. That's your job. That's the meaning of the shahada. That's the definition. So the definition is not to convert, is not to judge. It's to bring people to a point, they see the true Islam, and they make a conscious decision about it. That's the definition. How is it done? Through your example and interaction with people. Unless people ask you about your faith, then you answer. But other than that, it's just through your interaction and through your good example. When you become a good ambassador of Islam, you will not need to do a lot of talking. And as I said, if you are not a good ambassador, you'd better not even tell people that you are Muslim. Because then you're going to even bring negative results. So either way, if you are a good example, you will not need to do a lot of talking. And which you should. Through your example, through your interaction, and through your contribution. What is it that you as a person or we as a community contributed? What is it that we can show? Show nothing. Very little. That's down. Has nothing to do with judging people, has nothing to do with converting people. Dawah is about you being a good ambassador of Islam, good representative of Islam. And then if your example attracts people, they will ask you a question about your faith, you answer. You should be prepared to answer. That's what it is. That's the meaning of the shahada, to be a witness, not to be a judge. Allah didn't say so that you would be judged over people. Allah said to the Prophet, إِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ وَعَلَيْنَا الْحِسَابُ. Allah is saying to the Prophet, your job is to convey the message, our job is to judge. This is the Prophet. He's telling him, إِنَّمَا عَلَيْكَ الْبَلَاغُ. Your job is only to, and in exclusive way. When you say innama, means that's your job. That's your only job. Innama alayka, in another verse, ma ala rasuli illa balag. The only duty or job of the believer is, of the Prophet, is to convey. So if the Prophet was not assigned this job of judging people, who is any Muslim that comes after that who allow themselves to do it? So that's what da'wah, again, is all about. So it's not our job to judge people. It's not our job to convert people. Now, imagine you did this right. And somebody understood Islam exactly what it is. Through your behavior, through your interaction, and through your answers. And decided not to take it. So what? Yeah? So what? Becomes an enemy or somebody who deserves to be killed? No. Still a human being. That's Allah will take care of that. You're done your part. Now this person is your brother in humanity. And your brother in fellow citizen. The relationship between the two of you is what? Is governed by mutual respect, mutual acceptance. Accept each other, respect each other. If there is a way to cooperate for the common good, do it. That's all. Once you take away this judgment from your mind and you start seeing people not as Muslims or non-Muslim, seeing people as people, human being, dignified human being. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمْ. We dignified, not only Muslim, we dignified all the children of Adam. So what? People didn't accept. It's the end of the world. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam lived with many people who didn't accept the message. So what? They chose not to accept. They remain your neighbor. They remain your colleague. Remain very spontaneous relationship. They can be your friends. There is this idea of wala wa bara, that you can have friend only you can have only Muslim as a friend. Who said this? Who came up with these ideas? These are the ideas that we have to eliminate if we are serious, and inshallah we are, about rebuilding our deen, coming up with fresh construct. I mean, not fresh deen. Revelation ended with Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. That's it. Our job now is to not to wait for new revelation. That's ended. Our job, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose us for a very honorable and big job. We're just not fulfilling it. It's a job that was done by prophets before. It's the job for which Allah used to send prophets. Now He assigned it to you and me. That's a big honor. That's a huge honor. It's a big responsibility too, but it's a huge honor that Allah selects you to do the job of the, to continue the job of Muhammad sallallahu, and before that to do the work of Allah, to do his work, to do continue the job of Muhammad, and to do the job for which Allah used to send messengers. Now it became your job and my job. This is an honor that we cannot afford to pass. This is an honor, and it's an honor, and it's a big responsibility. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ لَكَ وَلِقَوْمِكَ وَسَوْفَ تُسْأَلُونَ. وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ, it's an honor, prestige for you and for your people. But you'll be asked about it. So it's an honor and responsibility. وَإِنَّهُ لَذِكْرٌ, it's an honor for you and for your people, addressing the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَسَوْفَ تُسْأَلُونَ, it's a huge responsibility, it's a huge, big honor and a big responsibility. Stop here inshallah, so that we'll have more room for interaction. Keep up with the time. What time is it now?
12:38.
Okay, still have time, good. Inshallah we'll manage to get interactive session and manage also to do some tafsir inshallah.
To understand and to use Quran in context of the environment that we are in now, who would take on the challenge of helping us understand Quran in the context? Because there are, right now there are plenty of books written on tafsir that are irrelevant for the
unfortunately, this is mainly the job of scholars.
Yes.
But if they are not there, then each one of us will have bigger responsibility. Each one of us should contribute to it. How do we contribute? And I mean, depending on your knowledge, you need to contribute, make a contribution that is proportional to how much you know. But everybody can contribute how? One is when you read the Quran, try to reflect. Use your brain. Ask a question. What does this verse mean? How can I apply it in my life? Reflection not only is okay, it's highly recommended. Now we confuse something, we confuse fatwa, that's for somebody who has the tools, has the knowledge. But reflection is for everybody. Everybody should be encouraged to reflect. So when you read the Quran, use your brain and try to reflect by asking, what does this verse mean? How can I best apply it in my life and in this context? Reflection. From the reflection come questions. You may not have the answer, and that's how when we get together, you ask somebody who knows, or you discuss with other people, and you search to find the answer to the question that you asked. So everybody should contribute to this effort, at least through reflection and raising questions. Because that's how we can get this momentum. As long as people are relaxed, nobody is reflecting, nobody is asking questions, then we remain stagnant. You want to have a dynamic, intellectual situation, everybody should participate through reflection and questions. And then through discussion among each other. And through research, and through asking people who know. That's the best way. There is no other way. As I said, I wish we came to the place where we find people who are doing this. Then we probably, our responsibility would be much less. Unfortunately, especially in our context, that job is not being done, and nobody who's expert is trying to do it, with very few exceptions. So it became our responsibility to step in and try to do something. So it's not going to happen overnight, but everybody should try to participate, as I said, reflect, think, raise questions. Don't be afraid to think, because the way we were taught Islam is basically by freezing your mind. Stop thinking. This is what we're told. I mean, there are people who make it even haram if you try to think about the meaning of a verse. While Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَقَدْ يَسَّرْنَا الْقُرْآنَ لِلذِّكْرِ فَهَلْ مِنْ مُدَّكِرٍ. We made this Quran easy for people. So now we're getting close to what? We're getting close to communities who settled for the idea. I mean, if you go to especially most Christian communities, etc., and Jews, most of them, they have this, they gave up and they accepted the idea that only the clergy can understand the Bible. So nobody need to try. No, there is no such thing in Islam. It is the responsibility of every Muslim to participate.
You talk about our kids, they are not following Islam. I think one of the problems in the colleges here, Muslim Student Association looks like foreign entity. Most of the leaders for Muslim Student Association come from foreign countries. And our kids, they are not happy with that. Words of Khatib Juma in the university, foreign kids. They are not talking to our kids as an American woman. I don't know if you realize that.
I realize that, they know it. This is a dilemma, unfortunately. This is an example of a culture that we developed as Muslims, which is the resistance to change. The MSA, the Muslim Student Association, was established for a specific purpose, which is what? Which is to preserve the identity of foreign student until they go home. And that was okay at that time, because most of the students at that time were foreigner and they're gonna go home. But things have changed, MSA didn't. You have different crowd, there are different needs, and you continue to do the same job by the same people. That's our ability to foresee change, so we don't foresee it coming, one. And second, even if it happens, we are very late to respond and adapt to change. So this is an organization that was established for a specific reason, and it was good for that time, which is any foreign student who comes, find a place, and find a small community in college, so that this person will find a place to pray, etc. That was the mission of the MSA. But now things have changed. Now 90 or 95% of the students on campus are people who are born and raised here are going nowhere. So you should change your charter. Now your job should be to help integrating Muslims in the college community, not to isolate them, to protect them. It should be the opposite. And now you should be addressing, like you said, in khutbah, and in your activities, the needs of the new crowd, which are different. This is a crowd of students who are born and raised here, and they're staying here. So to talk to them in about issues that are relevant elsewhere would make no sense for them. And that's part of the reason why the MSA is failing now to attract people. And part of the reason why most Muslim organizations are failing to attract people and to inspire people, because, as I said, most of them, even the Islamic Center, was established for the same reason, which is to protect the identity of people until they go home. Now people are not going home anymore, and now you have a different crowd altogether, the people who are born and raised here, and now they are the majority. So you should switch your discourse, you switch your priority, you switch your allocation of resources. Until now, we're still building mosques the same way we built them 10 and 20 years and 30 years ago, even though it's a different crowd and different needs. So that's an example of failure to adapt to changes. We still have MSA doing the same job, even though everything around has changed, including the people that you are serving. They are different, but you're still doing the same thing for, yes.
When you talk about improvement, are you talking about ijtihad in Islam? And when you talk about modernization of the message of Islam, are you talking about the ijtihad? Yani the ilm al-ijtihad?
Ijtihad is something that is, it's the prime responsibility of believers is to do this ijtihad, that we stop doing altogether. Why? So that we don't have that gap between deen that is fixed and life that is changing. So the ijtihad, which is to basically, how best to translate ijtihad? Ijtihad is what I...
keep up with the changing.
Yeah, it's basically to... it's basically to try to understand the Quran in the light of reality. The purpose of ijtihad is understood better by the outcome. The outcome is what? If it is done right, this deen will remain relevant. So ijtihad is basically the process to keep the teachings of Islam fresh and relevant. So it is needed. The key for ijtihad is what? Everybody, by the way, should be involved. As I said, everybody should be involved in this process. It's not only the job of scholars. As I said, people can contribute by reflection and raising questions, etc. When the key is what? We do ijtihad to do what? To keep the deen relevant, to fulfill the goals of Islam without violating the constant of Islam. There are things in Islam that don't change. So someone comes to do ijtihad about salah, you're wasting your time. That's not ijtihad. Right? Because that's one of the things that are fixed in Islam. There is no room for ijtihad in it. It's a five prayers, the way that the Prophet pray, we're going to continue praying till the day of judgment that way. That doesn't need ijtihad. So ijtihad, it's trying to fulfill the goals of Islam that I just mentioned, without violating the essence or the fundamentals of Islam. There are things in Islam that don't change over time. The Tawheed, believe in the oneness of Allah, the pillars of Islam, the Fara'id, the things that Allah has forbidden, the Kaba'id, nobody is going to make ijtihad one day and say, you know what, lying is okay. Why? Because we are modernizing Islam. No, that's out of the area of ijtihad. These are the what they call constant, fixed things that do not change. Ijtihad is basically can I live as Muslim in this time and succeed and excel in life and then represent or make my deen relevant and attractive and inspiring. That's the key for ijtihad. But it's not, I mean, the fundamental of Islam have to be preserved. Yes?
Yeah. We were talking about Abu Dawa over here also. But the majority of Muslims, they go to their homes, you know, the Jamaat Dawa, and you know, for 4 days, for 40 days, and all these things. I mean, what do you have it?
Oh, people are sincere and they were trying to do things. I don't want to judge anybody. I don't believe in this, in these ways of doing that. And I don't believe in brochures and banners, etc. I don't believe now, as Muslims, in door-to-door. You have very severe image problem. You're going to knock on people and tell them about Islam nowadays. We have to be realistic. These tools produce nothing. And you know what? Even if they produce, let's say somebody from the brochures that we distribute, etc., come to Islam. What kind of Islam is coming to? And what kind of community is joining? Let's say that it will work. Let's say that somebody, because of the brochures that we distribute, and because of the banners that we put in buses and whatever, or because of knocking on doors, they come to Islam. What kind of Islam do we have now to give? And what kind of community this person is joining? Most of the time, after they declare Shahada and we congratulate them, etc., we leave them alone. And then they detach themselves from their environment. They don't find any alternative. And that's why many of them, right now, many of them are going back. Because they didn't find what they were told and what they expected. They didn't find role models. They didn't find an inclusive community. to embrace them. They didn't, and then nobody even was put the time to teach and to share with them. Our issue nowadays is not da'wah. Our issue is to develop role models and try to fix this severe image problem that we have, which is going to take a long time, because it's not going to be fixed with words. Imagine now, let's say they give you a chance to appear in TV channel, media, and you come and say, our deen is great, or Islam is peace, Islam is about, I mean, what comes to the mind of people who are listening to you? It's the picture they see every day. It's the people who are blowing up buildings and the people who are slaying innocent individuals, etc. That's what comes to their mind. So it's no longer an issue of talking. It's an issue now, it's a much bigger problem. Now we have a problem of building the Muslim role models, and then hopefully these role models, through their interaction, through their contribution, through their success in life and in their career and etc., through their manners, will help changing this negative image so that da'wah can be done. Now we are now in the red. Let's get to the zero, and then we can talk about making da'wah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yesterday we had a session over here from 4 to 6 o'clock. And I think one of those was with us, there are some people, 10 to 12 people from some other church. I happened to get an email somehow, and I came like 10 or 15 minutes before that, because we were supposed to be a group of people to greet him and to just introduce ourselves into interaction. But when I asked the guy, I saw the guy first time in my life who was arranging it, and I said that we were supposed to meet at least before the meeting to have our own discussion and briefing and everything. No, it has been done on the internet. So I was lost also, but anyway I spent those 2 hours here. Well, we were all on before the Muslim seminar. They were like 12 people over here, but we did Allah's hijab.
You know, we're still doing activity for the sake of activity, in very poor planning. Nobody will sit down after, nobody plans ahead. Nobody sets goals or objectives for that activity, so that we can later on come sit down and evaluate what did we want to achieve and how much we achieved. Still, things are, as you put it, done in a very lousy way. Brother, yes.
I want to go back to the subject of da'wah and whatever Abu Abdullah said about children and so on. But I want to ask if anybody, I want to know which one of the present people was born in the United States. Can you raise your hand, whoever was born in the United States? 1, 2, 3.
4.
4. Okay, great. 4 out of probably 30 people were born here. And they're here listening right now.
You are almost born
to the top.
You came very young.
I was born in Sudan.
But you came very young.
Let's say 5 out of 30. This is very disturbing for me.
Yes.
Very disturbing.
For everyone.
25 out of 30 were born outside the United States. And we are here because of what we learned back home about Islam and not because what we learned in here. The disturbing thing is, what about my child? What about our children and our grandchildren down the road? You're not going to see more than 2 or 3 people instead of 30 people, because us are going to die in about 30 years from now. And then all these people were born in here, probably your children, those 5 people who were born here, their children probably are going to have about 2 people, in here and so on.
Yeah.
So what I'm saying is that the community, the leaders of the Muslim community, the mosque, everybody failed miserably to bring in.
And families and all of us.
And families, and start with us, the fathers and the mothers and the families, they all failed miserably into the da'wah of their own children.
Mm-hmm.
And we can be blamed partially, But also, we can blame the leaders of the Muslim community and the mosque and so on because they're not doing their part. And namely, I have a lot of Christian friends and some Jewish and so on, and Catholic and Mormons. And I know that their children go to the church because they love to go to the church.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because it's not about praying. It's not about learning Christianity. There is a basketball game mm-hmm. outside of the mm-hmm. church.
Mm-hmm.
There is a swimming contest somewhere else, you know, of the children of the church goers
yeah.
and so on.
Mm-hmm.
This is what we're missing. We're seeing a mosque in here who does not work with another mosque, and that other mosque does not work with another mm-hmm. mosque, and so on.
Mm-hmm.
These are Pakistanis, and these are Arabs. Egyptians, and these are whatever.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we need to really work on first as the basics. And you will end up and see 10 years from now, 10, 20 years from now, the results of the work that we do now.
I mean, you put it very nicely. I can't agree more. It's a cycle. If you have the right individuals, these right individuals will build the right family and the right community. Right now, none of them is right. Situation we have, individuals are not built properly, and therefore they go and build dysfunctional families, and you have dysfunctional community as you described. So we are in a vicious cycle that's very dangerous. And the way you describe it, if we're going to continue, that's what's going to happen in the future. From 5 to 2 to 0, to nothing. So it's not easy to break. There is no easy way or just one point to break this cycle and reverse it. This is part some effort that we're trying to do. But you're right, work has to be done on community and community leaders. So that at the end of the day, each one of us does his or her part. One. Second, family does its part. Third, community will do its part. That's what we want to reach. But there is no easy way to do that, because the worst thing when you find yourself in a vicious cycle, that things are feeding into one another. As I said, the individuals without the proper understanding of Islam will not build a very healthy Muslim families, will not raise a healthy Muslim children, will not contribute, will not be a solid building block for a strong community. And it's a community that is not strong will not provide enough support for individuals and for families. So it is, right now, it's all going backwards. What we're trying to do is try to find somewhere that we can break this cycle, stop it, at least, and start, hopefully, reversing it. Now we start with what we have, and we're still hoping, through the few young people who are here, and we talked about this before, and we met, and we're still working and trying, through the few young people here, to reach more young people, because they are the best ones who can help us reaching others. And better than that, not only helping us reaching more young people, themselves delivering the message to their peers, because they'll be the most equipped to do that. The few people who attend with us here, and as I met with Brother Osman, I told you have a huge responsibility. Why? Because you are those rare young people who are still, we can communicate with them, and we are talking to them. You have to be the link and the bridge to the huge young populations that are way away from the masjid and away from the community. So, no easy way. There is no one thing that if you do it, it's going to clean this mess. So things are very, very messy. And I'm very happy that we came to that conclusion, that we are no longer fooling ourselves, or we are no longer deceived by the size of the mosques and the size of the Jumu'ah crowd, etc. We're realizing that we have behind these appearances, there is a very severe, serious problem that needs to be addressed. I'm glad that we came to that conclusion. I'm glad that we are now talking solutions.
Right.
Because until recently and until now, What we discuss here, many people will reject it. Say, no, 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 we're okay. Well, alhamdulillah, we're praying, we have our Jumu'ah, we have etc. What are you talking about? We are okay. Because the way they understood Islam, that's okay. And second, because they don't look even 1 year from now. They see, they only limit themselves to what they see now. But they cannot try to foresee that if we're going to continue this way, where we're heading. So, I'm telling you, the final product is what? The final product is to build, to help build that Muslim role model who will go on and build healthy, very effective family that will produce, that's where the cycle will be reversed. And these people, these individuals and these families, believe me, they will build much better community than ours, and they will give much better image of Islam. But it is not the work of 1 year, it's not the work of weeks or months or years. This is the work of generations that we are trying to start here. Yes.
Absolutely. A quick comment is that, you know, I hate to bring in politicians saying into this, but over 20 years ago, Hillary Clinton said, it takes a village to raise a child. And you know what? It's not only about family, it's about the family, and it's about the village, and about the community, and about everybody.
Absolutely.
And I'm talking to all of you Muslims right here. It's not about Arab Muslims. It's about Arabs and Pakistanis and everybody from every community if we want to build Islam the right way. But we can keep talking all we want. You know, if we don't put it on pen, we don't use a pen and put it on paper. You know, and say, here's what we're going to do, 1, 2, 3, 4 from now, so we can see the result 10, 20 years from now, then nothing's going to happen. We can keep talking about it.
And what we're starting with is what? The reason we're resisting, we can rush to try to do things, but that's not going to fix the problem. The reason, the starting point, in my opinion, is to build that solid foundation and that frame of mind that then we'll use it to build individuals and build communities accordingly. The whole thing starts with idea. The biggest mistake that we made as Muslims is that we never appreciated the value of human resources. We're still thinking that nations will progress if they have wealth. Now we have Muslim countries that have wealth, they did not progress anywhere. And we have many nations recently who have made big jump without discovering any new natural resources. What did they do? They invested in the individual. You can see now our communities. There are a lot of activities, there are very nice buildings, but there is very little effort that goes into investing in mentoring people, teaching and mentoring people. So you're right, it's a big job, it takes a village, it's a responsibility of everybody, but I think this time some things have gone, I mean, way down. Let's try to do it right. I mean, one of the advantage, probably the only advantage, is when things collapse, is to give you a chance to do it right. Because as long as they did not collapse, you can always be tempted to remodel and to do this cosmetic and patchwork. But when things collapse, it's as sad as it is, but it gives you an opportunity to do it right. That's this time. Let's try to do it right, because, as I said, because of the time that we wasted, because we're coming very late, we have no room for mistake. If we're going to do it, we only have one shot to do it right, because we're talking about accumulation of centuries. So in any place, if someone want to do a revival, they have to make sure that it's done right, because we no longer have room for trial and error, or to commit mistakes.
I'm all for role model, being good role model Muslim. And I'm all for, you know, studying and doing the best you can by getting the best answer, you know, for yourself. But at the end of the day, we need some guidance. You know, I'm still confused. You know, I'm trying to be a good role model Muslim. You know, but I think we should put the priorities. You know, I mean, like the brother said, there's a lot of responsibility on the head of these community leaders. You know, why isn't there, a meeting like what we're doing? All these leaders get together and try to work for the best for the community, and start, implementing these ideas, good ideas, to attract these young people. You know, I have two kids. I can't get them to come here. I mean, we have to have some good attraction to bring them in here. We have some good ideas,
Very good. Very good comment. Very good question. I'm going to be very frank with you. This is, until now, it's a class. It's up to you. And I'm willing and I'm ready. You want to move to the next level? Just let me know. Next level is what you described. Next level will be a couple of things. Because this class will not do the job if we're going to continue forever. This class is the beginning. The next level involves two things. One is mentorship, one-on-one, and then ready for that. I mentioned before. Those who want to keep in touch over email, meeting, etc., and they did it. And I'm willing to do that. So that you're reading something, you have questions, you want to spend more time, etc., I'm willing to do that. The next level involves that we meet, not in a class context, but the meet to plan and to make things happen. And I'm ready for both. Just let me know if you, doesn't have to be all of you. If some of you are ready to move to the next level, then we're going to continue the class. The class will continue to do its part, but then we will have another track where we're going to do these couple of things, which is do actual mentorship and actual planning and work. And that will take us from a class to a working group. And as I said, the ball is in your court. And for me, the moment I find some of you willing to do that, you will find me there. Just let me know.
Sister, I've been trying to ask a question for the past half hour.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was just trying to add to brother, to this brother here. He's all over what he said. I've tried. See, I came here like 24 years ago. I had no kids. I had my kids here. Yes, it is one of them. I took them to the mosques. Some of the mosques could not take them. They did not want to take them. I was told once that, just from this country, it's not from Moroccans. Okay, I promise you this. This is what I knocked on the door. I was like, oh my God, I heard Quran, kids reading Quran and reciting. He said, sorry, ma'am, it's not for, where are you from? Is it Morocco? No, it's not. Okay, whatever. I went to another mosque. They say we tried so many things. I ended up going to Mustafa Center. They took them, they were young, and they did good. They stopped 14 years old. When you reach 14, when you become to understand stuff, they stopped you. I kept trying, it was impossible.
That's a big dilemma.
So this is one of the things I need to this brother here that we have to think of. I have a lot of sisters. They have young kids, and trust me, the other brother said, you cannot get them to come. When you say mosque, they say auntie, whatever.
I know.
We had a sleepover tonight, yesterday. The kid is in my house now. I could not make him to come in.
Can't force people.
Exactly.
I know. I know because there is, because for a long time there was nothing for them in the mosque.
Nothing.
And the mosque and the activities were not designed for them. And they didn't, the mosque was not youth friendly and still is not youth friendly. And you know what? It's not family friendly. The mosque is not family friendly. The way it is designed, it's not family friendly, it's not youth friendly. Why? Because it was designed for a segment of the community, of the male adult who are coming here for limited time and going back home. That's how the mosque was. It's like an MSA. That's how everything was designed. But everything has changed, and we are still the same people who are in charge doing the same thing, even though everything around us, including the crowd itself, has changed.
Why don't we have a session for kids only to come meet with you and ask whatever questions they have on their minds and for you to answer it?
And I said I'm willing, and I'm committed to this because, as I said, we have
all of our kids have questions. I mean, that sometimes we don't have the answer for.
I have no choice. I mean, it's basically this. I'm willing to talk to anybody who's willing to listen. So whether you want to meet to plan how can we reach young people, etc. Whether you can put the session for young people, etc. I'm there. I mean, it, just let me know.
Yes, can we start? Because yesterday, desperately, I was looking for some advice, and I tried to reach you. So, and I don't know the names of all these brothers, also or their contact number. If they don't mind, while we are getting together, can we just make a list of the people, and if they like to share the number for good reason?
The bank has the emails of people. Father Stamatis. So you can talk to him.
So. Wait, is it, I told you before that I do foster care with Fairfax County. I go to churches. I see social workers, teachers, people from all around. I mean, the places. They do like community things. They do gathering, they do classes for parenting classes. They do activities for kids. Guess what? Now I just found that they do senior stuff, I mean activities. Seniors go for a couple of hours, 3-4 hours a day. They do activities. Gym for seniors. Churches. These are churches open 24, no, it's not true. Opening, I mean, daily for these things. We don't have nothing in the mosque.
That's, you're still describing reality. It's a very sad reality. It's we were unable, or even we didn't even try, to convert the mosque into a community center. That's
yes.
A long overdue.
Yeah.
It's long overdue to turn mosques into community centers. Where you have all these facilities and all of these activities, and there is a prayer hall for those who are praying. But mosque the should be community center that is open for everybody. So everybody is welcome. And everybody will find something to do. And then the whole family will come because there are activities for all members of the family. And then there is a prayer hall. When the prayer comes, those who pray, they go, and even those who don't pray, they still should be welcome. You know, we dropped the about 80% of the community, and even the small fraction that remained were unable to serve them properly because their needs have gone beyond what the mosque has to offer. Right now, you can force a young child to come to the mosque up to a certain age, but then after that, you can't because I always say that people wonder why young people are not here, and I always wonder why they come here. And when I walk in the masjid and they find a young man or a young woman, say, why this person came? There is nothing in the mosque that will attract these people. It's a very sad reality. It's a very sad reality that is actually a lot of, because there is a lot of talking about youth. Youth is our priority. Go into any mosque. Youth are your priority, and then tell them, show me your budget. You'll find all the money spent somewhere else. So if it is your priority, then your resources should be spent on it. But it's not the case. It's just we're talking. And as I said, hardly anything in mosques is designed for them. So don't worry, don't blame them for not coming. Blame yourself for being unable or failing. One, to have a version of Islam that is inspiring to them. And that's what you said, that we are failing even to pass it on to our children. That's, they call it captive audience. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi called Yulad Mawlud ala al-Fitra. And in Mawlud, the newborn comes blank sheet. you write whatever you want. So basically, when you see your child, that's what you wrote. That's what you wrote. That's what you did. Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam put it this way. That's what we call captive audience, meaning these people are under total control for several years. And we failed to pass on, to pass this version of Islam to them, pass it on to them. It means what? It means that this is so poor of quality that we are unable even to sell it to a captive audience in our homes. Never mind to sell it to people outside.
Yes. I totally agree with you, and the issue, there are two issues in here. One of them is the lack of the mosque leaders and board members or whoever, their lack of understanding that the mosque need to be community center so we can get
everybody,
all these people over. The other issue is replying to what the sister said is that, and here in America we say, show me the money, okay? This is definitely show me the money about, you know, having the teachers and having certain activities funded and so on. And to us Muslims, we don't believe in that. We come out and in the church, you know, they pass the basket. And you don't know where the money is gonna go. Where is it gonna go to? It's going to go to certain activities and teachers and classes and lessons. Our money, when we get out of the mosque, we put it in whoever is outside soliciting, and we say, yeah, okay, I'm gonna give, this is sadaqah and this is zakah, because my, you know, I'm gonna give it, I'm gonna give sadaqah zakah because my reward is gonna be in Jannah. But if you tell them, you know, give me $1,000, give me $500, because we're gonna pave that area for a basketball court, they're gonna say, oh, the heck with that. You know, what kind of reward I'm gonna get in Jannah? I'm not gonna get my reward because it's a basketball court, you know, and it's not considered sadaqah, it's not considered zakat. And this is the lack of understanding of our deen al-azim. This is so we can build the new Muslim generations. And that's one of the ways to do that. We need to fund something like that. We need to pay teachers to do something. We need to pay coaches. We need to, you know, we need to find a way to fund. We're horrible about, you know, really finding funding channels, you know, to do that.
You know, from my experience, it's not the money. It's the vision and the leadership. This community is full of resources and talents that are totally untapped. If you go around in Jumu'ah, you will see many people with a lot of good ideas, a lot of skills, and a lot of resources. But they are not involved. Why? Because there is no vision and there is no leadership in place to inspire. And that's something that I say, it's very sad that the majority of our resources are intact, but that gives us hope. Give us hope, because if we did what we did now with very limited resources, human and financial, just imagine if we can leverage the resources of this community, what's going to happen. So it is not an issue of money. And I can share with you experiences, first-hand experiences in different communities where we discovered there are so many people with a lot of experience, a lot of expertise, a lot of money, but they were never, nobody involved them, nobody approached them, and they never saw something that makes sense. There is a vision. There is somebody who will not convince them always to donate, just to donate, but will put a plan, put a vision in front of them. There is, and that's what is lacking in our community. And that's what I believe is the key. In addition to building a fresh understanding of Islam, which is an intellectual work that we're trying to do, is also building a vision for the community that will rally the resources and the talents of the community, and you will see wonders. And I'm telling you, if we manage to succeed on these two tracks, one is an intellectual foundation, it's a fresh understanding of Islam that will free people from all the shackles and make them really think big and very ambitious, etc. And then manage to come up with a vision. And these are not really, they're not very difficult. It's a demanding job. It's not very difficult. Come up with a vision that is inspiring, and you will see a lot of people who are not involved will be involved. A lot of people who are not donating will start contributing, and a lot of talents that nobody knew about them will come on board. It's that what is missing is leadership with a vision that can rally the community.
I can just have a quick suggestion. Why don't we start in this masjid to make this masjid as our model, starting from the board members, the people in charge of this masjid, see if we can change, you know, for our community.
Suggest some activities and do them actually, but changing organizations or changing it's not easy, because you may find a couple of people who respond to you, and then when they try to work, when get the whole board and etc., a lot of resistance. This is unfortunately there is a culture now that we have, which is this resistance to change and the fear of any new ideas or major change. We don't want to try things. We want to remain in our comfort zone. So I'm not going to discourage, I'm not discouraging anybody. We tried before, we did an activity and it worked well.
They accepted.
So keep doing that. But don't forget about changing completely the priorities and the way a mosque operates. Believe me, it will not work. Organizations are basically, once they are established, they have clear priority, they have a culture of their own. They can accommodate you, but it's hard for them to become something else, to change it. So let's continue this discussion and continue the work. And I'm glad that we're converging to when it comes to diagnosis, and we are starting talking about solutions, which is a major step. Again, this work is demanding. It doesn't bring results immediately. That's why it's not usually. It's hard to remain patient. Even the companions, at certain time, they came to the Prophet and they were becoming very impatient. Because 13 years and things are not really moving. But as I said, Rasulullah was building the individuals who later on changed the whole world. So let's continue this class, continue this discussion. If you know somebody and you think that they can benefit, just bring them on board. Let's all continue this thinking and discussion of reaching out to young people. We have to break this barrier. We have to manage to find a way, directly or indirectly, through the four or five of you here, to reach out more young people and more young people who are not here. And there are many of them. So. Let's stop here. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك. أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت. أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. inshallah, we'll meet next Sunday at the same time, inshallah.